Hello. In this series of videos, I'm going to talk to you about the role of errors and inference. And you'll notice that what we have is error as a global issue. In any analysis, there's going to be error. And what we're going to do is we're going to unpack that whole global statement of error into its constituent parts. So that's why it's got errors in it. So why inference matters? Well, this is the classic example that I think a lot of people are familiar with. As you can see, this is the famous picture of Harry Truman holding up the Chicago Daily Tribune announcement in 1948 that says Dewey defeats Truman. Of course, as history shows, Truman defeated Dewey. And that's why Truman says, "Ain't the way I heard it." So what went wrong? Well, it turned out to be an inference problem that was a result of not understanding how the data that was analyzed was being processed. And so this is a really important point. We've spent a lot of time thinking about data, using fancy tools, how to link it, and so on. What's also really important is to understand how the data were generated. So what happened in this particular case was Gallup, which is a very good polling company, did a survey, and what they did was the survey was based on a phone survey. So they called up a bunch of voters and asked them, are you going to vote for Dewey versus Truman? It's more complicated than that, but that was the basic idea. Now, the core challenge here is that back in 1948, the people who had phones were wealthier than the people who didn't. So the population that was sampled was biased towards Republicans. And so the people who were surveyed overwhelmingly said they would support Dewey, but because the data were not representative of the entire population or the entire population of voters, the inference was incorrect. So this is the classic example of not understanding the data generating function. A more modern day example is this example, which is the Google flu trends error, set of errors. So as you may be aware, in this era of coronavirus, trying to figure out what's happening in relatively real time is extremely important for the allocation of resources to doctors and hospitals. So what Google started to do was they noticed that the correlation between the historical way in which we learned about flu trends, which was from the Centers for Disease Control, was pretty closely mapped by Google Trends, but Google Trends was able to pick up the likelihood of a flu being in a particular area much faster than the CDC. The Centers for Disease Control waited for reports to come in, they had to process them, they put out the information, and it might be a matter of a week or two difference between when the CDC was able to pick up on flu trends and Google Trends was able to pick it up. So what was Google Trends? Why was Google Trends faster? Well, the basic idea was when people get sick and they think it's the flu, they start typing into Google, how can I get medicine for my flu? What are the symptoms of flu, and so on. And so what started to happen was the information that was coming from Google Flu Trends was faster and sooner and just as accurate as the CDC publications. So then the thought was, well, why don't we just use Google Flu Trends rather than the CDC, because it's going to be better and faster, and by the way, a whole lot lower cost. The problem was this prediction worked super well until it didn't. And so David Laser and his colleague Ryan Kennedy put out a piece that documented the gap between the Google Trends and the actual estimate that started to appear. And in fact, the relationship between actual flu outbreaks and Google Flu Trends ceased to be so closely tracked. So what happened here? Well, it's a very similar problem to the one that happened, you know, 50, 60 years before, which was the sampling problem. The challenge was that we didn't know what the population was that was typing in Google Flu Trends. You only know who has typed it in. You only know how frequent it is. You don't know if there are multiple searches. You don't know if more people are coming in and asking the question. So in other words, you don't understand the population from which those estimates were being generated. So these are two classic examples, very different, obviously, approaches to collecting the data, but the same core problem is the inference that was drawn was affected by the way in which the data was collected. So that's, and it matters. It mattered for, obviously, the Chicago Tribune got left with egg on its face by making the wrong prediction for the purposes of trying to figure out whether or not and how to allocate resources. Google Flu Trends was not going to be as reliable as the CDC. So the issue here is not only that the population matters, but you need to think about bias in the way in which one the data are collected. So here, I'm not picking on Google, it's just that people use it a great deal. So suppose you wanted to study university professors, and you thought, well, a very good way of picking that up would be to do a search on Google, type in the word Google, the word university professors, and then go and find that information and do some analysis on it. So if you take a look at that particular picture of university professors, you'll see that Google's algorithm shows up with a marked demographic difference. In other words, that algorithm results in males. So when this was pointed out, you'll see that the change in the search mechanism and the data collection mechanism changed by September 16th of 2019, and you'll see it's a little bit more demographically balanced, that the data that you would collect as a result of this algorithmic search results in a very different population of study. So you need to keep in mind how biases can occur. Think about the population, it could be the algorithm whereby the data are collected and so on. So let's talk about what that means in practice. So really what we want to think about is how data are collected. In other words, what's the data generating function? So the world in which we used to live as social scientists, the data were designed. In other words, there would be a set of questions that one wanted to answer. One would figure out the population, one would figure out the study protocols, and you'd either go out and do a survey or you'd do an experiment. We'll talk about the sources of error that can come from that source in just a minute. Nowadays, more and more what we're seeing is data being generated organically. These can be referred to as the digital footprints that we generate in our day-to-day lives. It could be things like cell phones. It could be sensor data. It could be credit card data. Or it could be, and we're going to focus primarily now on administrative data. And we're going to focus on administrative data because the focus of this set of classes is around data for public policy. Administrative records are data that are generated as a result of the administration of government programs. So it's things like tax records, the administration of unemployment insurance programs, the administration of welfare programs, food stamp programs, could be medical programs and so on. Those are called administrative records. So they have some element of design and some element of being organic. But in practice, we're going to focus in right now on the sources of error in administrative records. We know a lot about the sources of error from surveys. If you take a look at chapter 10 of our textbook, you'll see that Paul Beamer, who is well known in thinking about the total survey error framework, is taking the survey error framework and translating it into this new context. So it's obviously becoming more important, not just for government work, but also in research. There's quite a famous piece by Einar Levine in the Economics in the Age of Big Data. And you'll see that over the past even 8 years, the use of administrative records accounts for about a quarter of all research. The use of private data like LinkedIn or Twitter or Facebook data are good examples of this, account for about 20%. So almost half of research by 2014, of published research, was accounted for by these new types of data, up from less than 10% even 8 years earlier since it's published. I'm certain that if you were to look at these data now in 2020, it would be probably three quarters of data are using a non-survey type of data. So what are the common data issues? So with the Harry Truman example, the issue was coverage. In other words, does the population on which you're collecting the data match the population of interest? Another issue is definitions. How do we code in information about what a university professor is? Sometimes the units of analysis might not exactly match the units of analysis of interest. Let me talk a little bit about each one of those, definitions and units of analysis. So a definition of unemployment, for example, might be the survey definition, which is employed for at least an hour a week in paid work during the week covering the survey week. And there's a couple of exemptions for working in a family business or working on a farm, but that's the general internationally accepted standard. Now, if you think about unemployed, there's been a lot of interest in initial claims for unemployment. It's a very different concept. It's people who satisfy the criteria in different states and who claimed unemployment. That's very different from the survey definition I just gave you. People might want to think about employment as being having a living wage, being employed with the same employer for a certain amount of time, being with a job that has benefits, or there are many, many different concepts that one might want to get at. And so thinking about whether your data measure gets close to the concept that you're interested in is very important. Say another example is, as I said, the units of analysis. Are we interested in individuals or households or families? Well, individuals are reasonably okay to measure. You've got a physical construct there. But when you're talking about households and families, that gets a bit more complicated. I don't need to spell that out. When we're talking about businesses, if we talk about an employer, are we talking about a single unit and a physical establishment like a physical McDonald's? Or are we thinking about a franchise which might have, you know, 10 establishments throughout a particular region that's owned by one individual? Or are we thinking about McDonald's as a corporate being? Or are we thinking about it as being a unit of tax analysis? Or are we thinking about it as being an employer that files unemployment insurance taxes in a given state? So you can see, you can have many, many concepts that are associated with a unit of analysis, and you have to be really clear on what you're talking about. We have to think about mistakes. Data are entered for particular reasons. When we work with corrections data, for example, when you're taking in people who are convicted of a crime and they are being processed at a state correctional facility, it may be that they don't get the exact perfect social security number or their exact perfect name, and there might be errors in that data. There might be missing values. This is very common in different types of administrative records. Usually the data that are required for the administration program are pretty good, but they're only going to be bounded by the remit of the administrative entity. So for example, if I'm working for the state of Illinois and I'm trying to figure out where people have earnings and employment, I'm only going to see them if they get jobs in the state of Illinois. I'm not going to see them if they have jobs in Indiana or in Ohio or Missouri. So the missing values in employment records might be that they really don't have a job, or it might be that they have a job out of state, or it might be that they've gone into community college, or that they've gone onto welfare, or that they've gone into corrections and so on. So the sources of the missing values in the data need to be understood. And it all goes back to understanding the data generating model. So what you really want to do is process the data to get as close to possible as what you're interested in collecting the data at. And what we'll see later on is the source of the errors can actually severely bias your parameter estimates, both for single variables and also for the interconnections between the variables. And this is a classic quote. I love this quote, so does my colleague, Frauke Kreuter. You should be thinking about data quality problems throughout your analysis, rather than just waiting for it when you make a presentation or when you make a report to your boss or to your colleagues or to your peers. You don't want them just to show up and someone saying, have you thought about that? You should be thinking pretty hard about the sources of the errors. And we'll talk about this in more detail in the next video. And where it fits into this class and this whole set of thinking, you really want to be thinking about inference as you're evaluating the quality of your analysis. So we've got it towards the end, obviously, of this thought process, but you should be thinking about it throughout the analysis. As you can see, I have a set of questions that I'd like you to be thinking about, and look forward to seeing your responses to that.